The goal of this group has been to do an animated feature from the day I started.
This was the holy grail of computer graphics, to get to the point where you could do the feature film.
It was the first feature any of us had had any weighty creative control over. We just never thought about that because that would just get too intimidating.
The biggest thing this film does to advance computer animation, I believe, is it tells a story.
You are a toy!
This film is driven by characters and story first. And even though it is the first ever computer animated film, the technique that we're using is secondary to the story that we want to tell.
I think if there had been another movie done in this technology, you'd still feel like you were seeing the first of this kind of film because of what John does with his characters. It's a very different thing.
I remember the moment when I first saw computer animation of any kind. I was working at Disney as an animator, and two very close friends of mine were working on Tron. And the moment I saw it, I was like, this is it. This is the next step, the next plateau. This is the future. I knew that computer animation wasn't a whole new medium. It was just new tools within the medium of animation. So all the things that I learned as far as principles of animation and film grammar still apply. And so when we started working with it and making short films, the most important thing to every one of my films was story and the characters. That drove everything.
What we wanted to do was every year do another piece and keep advancing the state of our animation tools so that he could do better and better animation. And that's the way we all looked at it. He was part of the development team.
I had all these things that I wanted the system to be able to do. And Tintoy was the very first use of the new animation system and the new rendering system that went on to be RenderMan. Also with Tintoy, I first started developing this notion of a juxtaposition with the audience. It's where you can show them something that they are so familiar with. And then all of a sudden you make them look at it from a different point of view, like looking at a cute little baby from a toy's perspective. From a toy, that's a monster. And we were inspired from Tintoy with the ideas that we had developed in there of toys being alive. So we came up with the idea for the buddy picture with two toys.
In the original idea, Tinny was on a family vacation with his owner, and he gets lost at a rest stop. There he's found by a junk man who chucks him into the back of his truck. In the back of his truck is this old ventriloquist dummy, and they decide to stick together. But at the end, they finally end up in kind of a toy heaven at a preschool where they'll never get lost or never get outgrown. But then the storyline changed to a kid's room, and the kid gets a new toy for his birthday and is brought into the room with all the old toys. But it didn't make sense that an old-fashioned tin toy, like Tinny was, would become a kid's new favorite toy. So we had to come up with our own action figure.
The goal was to make Buzz the toy that any boy would just die to have. We actually went through all of our favorite toys and added everything we could think of.
And everybody had their own coolest toy, but we tried to incorporate as many things as we could into one toy.
We started out with the name Lunar Larry, but then it evolved to Tempest from Morph, and ultimately became Buzz Lightyear.
Woody, the older toy, was based on... Here. It was based on him. This is my Casper from when I was a little boy. This is probably 37 years old. And see, he has a pull string. See, that's "Can I stay with you?" It's like a parent understanding their child's words. See, that's "I'm a friendly ghost."
We felt it makes sense that Woody doesn't look immediately like a kid's favorite toy and that he's a little bit more antiquated.
Then that made us think, well, maybe the old toy shouldn't be a ventriloquist dummy with top hat and tails. It was Bud Lucky that said, "Well, why don't you make him a cowboy?" And I thought, oh, that's perfect. You've got the frontier of space and then the frontier of the West. And so for a while, he was a ventriloquist dummy that was a cowboy.
We did these tests early on of Buzz and Woody, A, to test the models, the puppets themselves, you know, how do they move? Are we going to be able to use this model through a whole feature film? But then B, and more importantly, what is this character all about? How does the inner personality that we've created in the storyboard get expressed through movement? We were just trying to find the character, basically.
We made this test because a lot of people thought that an audience would not sit through 70 minutes of computer animation. People were used to hand-drawn animation, and I knew that when our imagery was lit, textured, and rendered, no one had ever seen anything like this before. It had the feeling like you could reach up there and touch those toys. And that's what we wanted to show the Disney folks and others, what Toy Story was really going to look like. And once we showed it, all the doubts went away.
Hi, pal, what you doing?
I'm Tempest from Mars.
Yeah, what's this button? Say, you weren't thinking of flying, were you?
Well,
you know Andy loves toys that can fly.
Really? Well then, to infinity and beyond.
You know, Andy loves toys that he can find.
We knew that this was something that they hadn't done before.
We've never made a buddy movie. We've never made a movie set with this level of contemporary human type characters.
Typically, a Disney film is fairy tales, retelling of fairy tales.
So what we're doing with John is something we've never had the license to do before.
Here's a chance to put our money where our mouth is and say, okay, you've been complaining about this feature and that feature, and if I were to do an animated feature, here you go, and let's do it. And so we kind of took that attitude and just did what we felt was right, regardless of if it bucked the system.
I think I know what to do. We're going to have to break a few rules, but if it works, it'll help everybody.
They took a line from Turner and Hooch, which was a movie I had made for Disney, and they actually did have a small piece of computer animation, which was Woody, saying the line. It was kind of amazing.
Oh, no, 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 you're eating the car! Don't eat the car! Not the car!
Oh, you stupid!
It fit. You know, if I had come in and seen something that didn't make quite as much sense, I don't know if I'd be doing the movie, but I saw Woody and he talked like I did, so it all made perfect sense.
Tim Allen, as the voice of Buzz Lightyear, he is really appealing. And he can play the macho guy, but with a soft underbelly, you know?
No, 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 go, go, just go, I'll catch up.
I was actually acting in there a little bit. There's a whole bunch of, you hated it though.
It's very interesting because in the beginning, Buzz Lightyear was much more superhero-like, much more Dudley Do-Right. And when we started getting Tim in for the recording sessions, he was putting a spin on it that was much more realistic. So we evolved the character, and it's much better to where he is just like a cop.
Watch yourself. Pals, who goes there? Do you know these life forms?
Yes. They're Andy's toys.
Every animator in his heart is a toy nut. Every animator is a child at heart. I mean, I think you have to be in this medium. And so you walk around Pixar, you walk around Disney for that matter, every desk practically is filled with toys.
I think even if we were making a movie about whales, we would be talking about our toys in the off hours or at lunchtime every day. So we really picked probably the most apropos subject to be making a picture about. I mean, how good you can tell a story is so much about research. And every one of us is an authority on toys.
We focused on each toy and looked at the toy, studied the toy, thought about how it was manufactured with quality of plastic, whether it was a cheap toy, whether it was an expensive toy, all these things, and combined these together to draw the personality out of it. You know, Rex. We had a number of toy dinosaurs around, and they were like cheap plastic, puny arms, cheesy spray painting, you know, yet he's supposed to be this fearsome meat eater. So we thought, this is where the personality could come from, of a very neurotic, insecure dinosaur.
I just don't think I can take that kind of rejection.
Mr. Potato Head. His facial features fall off, and that's where his personality comes from. I mean, I think you would be mad at the world if your face kept falling off all day. One of the great moments in Toy Story is the Green Army Man scene. Everybody knows these toys. There's a few, you know, basic characteristics that we had to have. One, gun barrels always bent. Two, They have the mold flashing, the bits of extra plastic around their head. Three, their feet are attached to the bases. So if, when we were putting Green Army Men in our film, we had to have those three things.
I got some old sneakers, I got a piece of plywood, and I nailed the shoes down to the board, and we tried walking in this thing and videotaped animators doing this. It was that experience and the analysis that allowed us to convincingly animate the Green Army Men.
While all this is going on, Ralph Eggleston and his amazing staff designed all the sets in the film. And we're talking about the neighborhood, the street, the trees, the leaves on the trees, the houses.
One of the things we tried to do with this film was to remove it from its computer look. You have so many choices on the computer. It's not the choice. It's what you leave out. In a lot of ways, it's not what you put in, because you have a bazillion colors. Do you really want to use every one of them? The thing that the computer does easiest is straight lines, and we have our share of straight lines because this is a film with a lot of architecture. But we tried to soften it by rounding the corners slightly here and there and using a lot of specialized lighting. What we wanted to do was make it believable.
One of the things that makes Toy Story so unique is the collaboration between traditionally trained artists and animators and these amazing computer geniuses.
In computer animation, you get nothing for free. Every object you see on the screen has to be created from scratch. You start with blueprints. We call them model packs. And then that's given to a modeler, and they create the model within the computer.
My ship!
And that's how we created the box that Buzz Lightyear came in.
Blast! This'll take weeks to repair.
For organic shapes, like Buzz's face, we get them in the computer a different way.
I'm entering some data from the surface of this clay model. We want to accurately capture the shape of it by sampling points on the surface with this digitizer wand. Once we have enough of these points, we can fit a mathematical surface through the points.
We built the system that allowed us to build in essentially facial muscles, to sort of represent muscles in a simple form. I mean, it's not the full complexity of the human body by any means, but still facial muscles that could allow him to lift the side of his mouth, to twinkle his nose, eyebrow movement, and all sorts of things that are part of character expression. Then to give that to the animator and give them that level of control.
Our system is designed for these traditionally trained animators with no computer experience whatsoever to sit down within a couple weeks, start animating.
To move Woody, I just move the controls. This is his elbow. I can move his elbow up or down. The next one down is the wrist. I can move his wrist however I want him to look.
I think if you can actually make it work and read and communicate without any facial expressions, without the use of your face, then you've done a really successful job. So actually what we tried to do is get everything to read just in the acting, the pantomime, and then when you stick the face on, it'll only plus that.
Buzz, look, an alien!
Where?
The story led, the art direction, the lighting, the music.
We knew that we had a great process, a technique that looked really different and that was unusual, but we knew also that what really was going to sell the picture was a story.
And we felt that the palette was really limited in animations up to that point of what kind of stories we were getting. And so it was a real conscious effort with Toy Story to just do something different. I remember early on just saying, wouldn't it be funny if we just showed a film where they were stuck in our world? And when the doors close, they're stuck in that room for who knows how long until somebody calls on them. And we thought, that's kind of an adult slant that people can relate to. And then to put even more on that, give them sort of a hierarchy and an attitude towards their job, basically, that's like the workforce.
What matters is that we're here for Andy when he needs us. That's what we're made for, right?
We worked out the story shot by shot with the writers and the storyboard artists.
We spent about 3 years storyboarding and re-storyboarding the movie over and over again, which is our way of rewriting. We don't stay with the script form for too long. Once we think we got something working, then we want to see it and react to it on the screen. So we draw storyboards like comic book panels. Once we have a scene storyboarded the way we like it, then we go and record the actors.
You do every line probably 17 times until the next time you come back, and then you do it another 17 times. All those 17 ways have to be different one from the next.
And each time he's giving us choices, each time is slightly different. And
in this, you know, we've much of his lines we've pieced together out of like three or four different takes.
No. I'm gonna try one of these big ones here at the beginning.
No. 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 No.
Right there. No. No. No.
No. No. No. No. No. No. No.
Yeah, I think I'll use that one last little thing at the end there.
No. No. No.
Yeah. So that's four, right?
Right.
No. 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 No.
I'll cut the storyboards together with the voices and then add music and sound effects, and we'll look at it up on the big screen. And then instead of feeling like we're just watching a bunch of still storyboards, it has the feeling of a real movie. Once we're happy with the storyboard and we feel like the story's being told well, we can finally move into the world of the computer. We begin a process called layout, where we essentially figure out which models, which characters we need in the scene, where we're going to put the camera, whether the camera's moving or not. And once we're happy with that, we can then pass the footage off to the animators, and they can do their magic and bring the characters to life finally.
Rockets explode!
The next step is to bring the image to life. We add lighting and shadows and textures and color. All the things that will ultimately make the image believable.
When it came time to animate Scud, I really wanted to have that sense of a believable run. And to get that, we looked at the Edward Muybridge book, which gives you all sorts of information on the order of the feet placement on the ground, the push-off with the neck, the arch reversal on the back, because before you can caricature, you have to know what is reality.
Ready, set, go!
A lot of us really played hard with our toys, but even though in our eyes in the movie Sid's a bad guy and he does bad things to toys, it's somewhat more true to how we were.
We all agreed that Sid was the kind of kid who would grow up to be an animator.
I burned her head the other day with a magnifying
glass.
Did you
really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Tried to burn her lip.
Everything you see on the screen has to be defined in terms of color and texture.
Bubble.
Once the textures and colors are chosen, the painter would take those and caricature them slightly. And then they'll work with a technical director to actually apply those paintings onto the objects, and that's what you'll end up seeing in the final film. The technical director will work with the painter on what kind of aging do we need? Does he have dirt on his pants? Is it shiny? Is it matte? Is it furry? Is it fuzzy? Is it cloth? What do we, as artists, want to project to the audience that this object feels like?
With Disney animated films, they're always musicals. And the music in ours, we wanted to be slightly different.
You got a friend in me. You got a friend in me.
Instead of the characters breaking out into song, we have the songs that are written about the emotion of the moment in the film, but it's sung by Randy Newman.
You just remember what your old past said, or you got a friend in me.
Coming out of doing the short films for John, there was a specific style that the sound took based on the images having weight and three dimensions and a reality to them. You see Mr. Potato Head and Woody and these characters walking, and they look real, they look three-dimensional, so they need realistic sound in a way that traditional animation doesn't. Every character in Toy Story had a unique sound signature because most of them were toys we would recognize. This movie has a combination of sound approaches, some of which are a little more cartoony because the sound effects are funny, but sometimes it's real, it's big, it's heavy, and it's like an action film when it needs to be.
That looks so great.
We were like pioneers, and it was so exciting. Every day you would go to work, and there would be like something new on the monitor, on the screen, and you're like, wow, that's great! When we were starting Toy Story, we knew that we would probably be making the first computer animated feature film. When it got animated, it was even more exciting. But nothing prepared us for the step that it took after it got fully rendered. My jaw was on the floor. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. And I mean, I directed the movie. I knew what was coming up, and I couldn't believe how amazing it looked.
This isn't flying, this is falling with style.
Toy Story is just the very beginning of what can be done in this medium. And it's just the first inkling of what can achieve here.
It isn't often one can say,
I had a lifelong dream and we fulfilled it. And now in fulfilling that, we can look and say, we've now started something extraordinarily new, and it's going to forever change the way that animated films are made.
Everybody's going to notice and talk about the fact this is the very first computer animated feature film. But the computers are just tools. They didn't create this picture. It's the people that created the picture. And we had such a fantastic group of people. And I had so much fun working with them. And that's what I'm going to remember for the rest of my life.